Hello, I'm Sabine O'Hara, Dean of the University of the District of Columbia's College of Aquaculture, Urban Sustainability, and Environmental Sciences. Welcome to Causes. On location at Merkirk Aquacultural Experiment Station Farm out in Beltsville, Maryland. As an urban land-grant university, the University of the District of Columbia conducts aquacultural research and provides community education and support for local farmers and community gardeners. Conventional farming is not possible in most parts of the District of Columbia, so the University of the District of Columbia conducts research in methods that make farming viable in urban areas and small spaces. In this edition of Causes, you will learn about two different methods of growing food that will truly revolutionize food production and will allow us to grow a lot of food in very small spaces: hydroponics and aquaponics. Our current world population is 7.2 billion people and is projected to increase by another billion over the next 12 years and reach 9.6 billion people by 2050. Most of that growth will come in developing countries on the African continent, and most of it will take place in urban communities. This makes it absolutely imperative for us to come up with new ways of growing food more efficiently. The University of the District of Columbia's hydroponics and aquaponics greenhouses are both demonstration projects and training centers for university students and for residents of the District of Columbia. The two working greenhouses are exploring efficient technologies for food production that can be used in urban environments where soil contamination or space might be an issue. University of the District of Columbia professor Thomas Kakovich is an applied mathematician and environmental engineer. He's also the author of 4 books on theoretical physics and holds 26 patents from many different countries. He is the creator of a water aeration system called the Flovex, and it is a system that we're using here at our experiment station farm to inject large amounts of dissolved oxygen into water for our aquaponics systems. I spoke with Professor Kakovich about his aquaponics research. Professor Kakovich, describe to us the science behind aquaponics. How does it work?
It's basically interconnecting atmosphere, the hydrology, and living fish. And the way you do it, you have to understand that atmosphere is living, water is living, and of course the fish within it is living, because we have bacteria everywhere. And to maintain that in a continuous flow, what we have to do is have a system that is continuously working, just like the body. And we cannot have a part of it shutting down and the other part living. You know, that's impossible. That is basically the hard part of maintaining an aquaponics. The three systems, three living systems, they have to function together continuously.
And then what happens?
What you have is that the atmosphere has 20% oxygen, 80% nitrogen, plus and minus some traces of water and CO2. When you insert that oxygen and nitrogen through aspiration systems into water, is dissolving the oxygen immediately but not the nitrogen. And then what happens, the fish of course uses the oxygen, and then the nitrogen will be later on used for different purposes. The fish has to produce the excrement, which it does, and then what happens is that the excrement is used as fertilizer for produce.
So the three elements of the aquaponics system are the air, the water, and the fish, And the fish, of course, produce excrement that becomes the fertilizer. What connects those different elements of the aquaponic system?
What connects it is the atmosphere is back there sitting by itself, and water is back here and fish is here. What connects them is actually water pump, water. The working fluid for the whole thing is water. We push water molecules through the pump and let the molecules do the job. We do not have moving parts. We basically have what we call smart pipe that knows exactly how much flow gets in, what kind of a gallon per minute, GPM, it receives, under what pressure, and it will basically take care of everything else, including all the flow, the amount of oxygen that has to be dissolved, and moves it right through. The only thing we use is water molecules. That's what connects them.
So what are some of the design challenges of a system like this?
What we have is this. A normal condition, what they use to insert any part of atmosphere, in this case, obviously oxygen, and to water, you need a compressor. Compressing atmosphere is basically generating heat. Generating heat will kill the atmospheric bacteria. It is very important to realize that bacteria is very important for us. So what we have to do is not compress, not to use compressors, which is basically what they use, but to come up with something totally different that will do aspiration and create suction and move the bacteria, oxygen, nitrogen all together while it's dissolving oxygen simultaneously with water molecules. That was a challenge, and of course we have solved that problem.
So the oxygen is obviously key to keep the system running smoothly. How do you get the oxygen from the air, which is a gas, into the water, which is a liquid?
And that is by far more challenging technology than it appears to be. We have a system, we call it FlowVex. It is basically what we also refer to as smart pipe. What happens is that the only thing that that smart pipe needs is water. It has no moving part, nothing, but it has to function absolutely as a pump and a motor. What happens is that how do you insert atmosphere, which is basically lower pressure, underwater, which is higher pressure. You know, from low to high pressure, usually that's not the way it's done. I know they do it to Venturi, but this is not the case. So that was the first challenge, how you go from low pressure to high pressure. But the second is how do you extract energy from the water pump, which already has pumped water through it. That is the key scientific breakthrough, that we have a chamber that is completely designed to have the rotation of water molecule such that it will create an angular momentum that will provide us with the energy that we need to extract atmospheric air, which is low pressure, and to a deeper water, which is high pressure.
But something has to be moving.
That is correct. What happens is that the design of that FlowVex system is that you have no moving part except the water molecules have to get inside the chamber, rotate around 30,000 RPM, and then added to that, there is an angular momentum water molecule that the product of the two produces the energy required to take the atmospheric air and put it in water and dissolve it simultaneously. That's the key. To dissolve the oxygen and one pass through simultaneously. Every 90 gallon per minute of water has dissolved oxygen of 7 to 8 parts per million of oxygen.
And what exactly is the difference between aquaponics and hydroponics?
My understanding, hydroponic requires fertilizer. And aquaponic, we have fish that actually, the fish is a byproduct. What actually this aquaponic is doing, that becomes a fertilizer factory for the produce. And you do not need any more fertilizer.
So the fish, you said, are like a fertilizer factory that creates excrement, and then we can use it either to grow the plants hydroponically right in that liquid that comes out of the fish tanks, or we can grow them using the liquid as fertigation, fertilizing and irrigating plants that are growing in soil. So what's next? How do you see the system being adapted in the future?
What we have done is that we have basically turned it into a solid state. By that I mean we put all the pieces, everything together, the fish tanks and the pumps and the power generator, everything in one piece into container 8x40. And then we could take it anywhere and drop it anywhere. And that is what I see. I see it as a really franchising system that people could use into any kind of farming, because it is fertilizer factory. Bottom line, that's what it is.
So this particular aquaponic system is also very energy efficient. Explain a little bit about what makes it so efficient.
It's extremely efficient. Actually, what we do is this. The power that we need is about 1 horsepower water pump. We do not need compressor. We do not need fertilizer. And when you add all this together, it becomes very economically feasible, because water is the only thing that we're moving, and we do have a generator for the backup, because any time that power goes, the fish will die. Obviously, the generator does not have to be used there, but we have it there, just in case. But efficiency is basically you have a pump that has 1 horsepower, water pump. That is, I would call that efficient.
Where can the system be used?
This could be used practically everywhere, with one powerful place that no one has used it so far, is urban area. What we could do, we could set up the aquaponics almost anywhere. We do not use compressor. I mentioned that again. We do not use liquid oxygen. That's almost illegal nowadays. We use only 1 horsepower, which is moving water, and produce the oxygen level that we require for fish. This could be used in any urban area, small areas, developing countries, and all over. And it is very small. The scale of it is basically 8 feet by 8 feet by 40 feet.
Can anyone run an aquaponic system like this? What about training?
With some training, yes. Like everything else, you cannot buy a car and drive it without a license. You know, we do offer certificates, and then they have to be trained on that. And there will be some online courses that they have to do it. And after all, it is farming, and it is requiring some time. You know, it's a living system. It's like a child. You have to feed it, you have to change it, you have to clean it. It's exactly what it requires. But yes, anyone could do it.
As an urban land-grant university, we conduct research on urban food production, agriculture, and gardening, not just for professional farmers, but for people like you. What distinguishes the University of the District of Columbia from other land-grant universities is our emphasis on urban sustainability. Conventional farming is typically not possible in cities because we don't have wide open spaces in the District of Columbia. So our research has to focus on food production that is viable and efficient in urban environment. Peter James has been developing high-tech products for over 40 years. Currently, he is the director of First Fruit Farms, an open-source urban farming project and research farm in Germantown, Maryland. First Fruit Farms is developing robotics and renewable energy systems to make urban farming economically viable. His work with us at the University of the District of Columbia focuses on technologies of hydroponics. So, Peter, we're here in this greenhouse with a very interesting setup. Most people would think that the way to grow vegetables is in soil, but this here really proves that that's not necessary. You can grow vegetables quite nicely without any soil. So tell us what we're looking at here.
Yes. Well, these are five different types of hydroponic systems, and hydroponics is growing in water. Mm-hmm. And there is sometimes some sterile media, whether it's perlite, which is this rocky stuff, or
very light,
made out of volcanic rock.
Uh-huh.
And it's light, it wicks water to give to the plants, and also allows air to get to the roots, because mm-hmm. the roots like air. And then there's this rock well, which is also like cotton candy spun out of rock. It's a
feels
mineral
a little wool. Bit like a very fine steel wool, sort of.
It's called mineral wool as well. It's used for insulation in homes, and this type is specially treated so it absorbs water, where the mm-hmm. stuff in the home is treated so it repels water. And this is a seedling, so we put the seeds in there, and usually a seed will come out without any nutrients, but once they get going, we start feeding them water that has the nutrients already contained. So what these are, we have five different types of both commercial and then systems you can use at home if you want to.
Mm-hmm. So which one is the easiest to use? You said water floats through here. This looks like pipes.
Well, this is one of the easiest ones. It's and it's also one of the most popular ones they use in commercial growing. It's called a NFT, which stands for nutrient film technique. And what it does, it takes a few millimeters of water and flows it continuously down these pipes. Now, commercial growers, instead of using round PVC pipes, have basically flat gullies that allow the roots to spread out a little bit more.
Mm-hmm.
And so what you do is you mix up a bucket, or in this case we have a trash can full of nutrient water, and it just continually circulates.
So the nutrients you buy, they come in a bottle, or
well, if you want to do it yourself, you can just go out to Miracle-Grow, which is not as water soluble, but mm-hmm. there's special websites for hydroponics that you can mm-hmm. buy specially formulated and nutrients that are water soluble and made for hydroponics. And then now the growing trend is starting, there's some manufacturer suppliers that have organic mm-hmm. nutrients, and mm-hmm. there's
so it's not quite water, it's water
it's
with
enriched with all the ideas trying to provide the plant with the optimal amount of nutrients. There's essentially 16 essential nutrients for plants to survive. Three of them come out of the atmosphere in the form of oxygen and some nitrogen and carbon. Most of the carbon that goes into the plant just comes from the atmosphere,
mm-hmm.
and then the water from the.
So, and of course, we usually talk about the big three in agriculture and gardening, right? Nitrogen,
yeah.
and
potassium,
phosphorus, and
phosphorus.
Potassium.
Yeah, those are the three big, and those are the most things when you have to, over a period of about a month, you want to sort of regulate, you add nutrients as needed, or add water as needed, and those are the three biggest consumables for the plant.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Probably nitrogen's the
so basically those little cushions that you just showed us, you kind of stick them in there, right?
Yeah,
in that pipe.
Yeah, see the roots growing.
Yeah,
from that one.
All the way through.
When the
Amazing.
Roots are white, you know you have a healthy plant. Mm.
You know, we've noticed when we've looked at these systems in here in this particular greenhouse, they grow very quickly. Is that just sort of my imagination?
If you can control the environment, they will grow, and you usually get, they've set up to 10 times the production of field crops, because you can pack them optimally, you don't have to worry about pests, and by giving them the optimal nutrients, and hopefully light and other conditions, you can actually add carbon dioxide increase by upwards of 40% your plant growth by supplying extra carbon dioxide to the system.
So because the plants need carbon dioxide to grow?
The plants will, they can be, there's probably about 400 parts per million in ambient air, and if you have a closed greenhouse, they'll suck all that carbon dioxide out of it and they'll stop growing. So either you need to ventilate the greenhouse well, or you need to supplement. A lot of commercial growers have Even home growers, they make carbon dioxide generators that mm-hmm. will feed the plants, and then you can really get good production.
So do they then also enrich your oxygen in the environment?
That's to a lesser degree, because you know you've got a lot more oxygen in the atmosphere, but they not only will output oxygen during the day, they use oxygen just like
at
people
night.
Do,
mm-hmm.
but during the daytime they will produce excess oxygen. But they also, a lot of plants will actually become biofilters for volatiles in the air. NASA's done a study and found that they looked at a lot of house plants, but some of these plants also, most of them will be taking volatiles out of the atmosphere to cure. So if you want to combine this in an urban setting with classrooms, we actually have some, we don't have anything in them, but we have some window troughs that if you have no space at all, but in a typical classroom or something, you have a long bank of windows, those mm-hmm. would be appropriate.
So you said, ideally, you will have nutrients dissolved in your water in a way that optimally feeds the plants.
Yes.
So the plants stay healthy and they grow rather quickly when
yes.
they have sort of an optimal level of nutrients.
Yes.
So what's involved in that? You're going to have to monitor it somewhere, right?
Yeah,
to know how much is in there.
Yeah, there's handheld monitors you can get on Amazon for $15. The two things most growers, until you get very sophisticated, is you want to measure something called EC. And EC is a electrical conductivity. And the more ions you have in the water, the higher the conductivity. So that will give you basically your concentrations. But really in these systems, you mix them up and you really want to start over at least at once a month, if not every 2 weeks. So because you're not tracking the individual nutrients, you don't know exactly how much nitrogen or potassium is being uptaken by the plants.
Well,
you really need to start over. Now, more higher volume growers that can afford the lab fees or the monitoring systems in the U.S. it seems like they do it, but maybe once a week or twice a week. And in some places where they do a lot of this type of commercial growing, they'll send it out on a daily basis and regulate the amounts of nutrients to be optimal.
Both the macronutrients and the micronutrients. So there's
a whole battery of
tests.
They will give you everything that those list of 13. Mm-hmm. nutrients that you put in the water.
But for the for the home producer, if you just sort of follow the instructions on the liquid fertilizer bottle,
you can get it mixed up, and then you put X amount per mm-hmm. gallon of water, and then mm-hmm. you also want to measure. The second thing you want to measure is the pH, mm-hmm. because each one of these nutrients is affected by the pH that's in the water, and we like for most of these plants in here to be about slightly acidic, anywhere from 5.5 to 6.2 in pH, and that allows the optimal amount of absorption. So iron acidic, it slows down the absorption, but most of the other nutrients, it improves the absorption. So you pick a kind of optimal point where it's going to get the greatest amount of uptake. And really the depletion of your nutrient water will mostly come from the three big, the
NPK, nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium.
And then occasionally you may want to add things like calcium, sulfur, probably the two things. Right now these potatoes need some more potassium. When these fruit sets starts to set, you need to really double the amount of potassium.
Mm.
So that's in a commercial growing, we actually have two nutrient mixes. Tomatoes will have those first two that mix together, and then the third, when the set comes in, it's like the potassium nitrate.
Mm.
It is, there's a lot of stuff. If you want to do it really, really good, there's a ton of information you need to kind of pick up. It's sort of being cooking up some soup and hot dogs for the kids versus the master chef. So that's the range.
The whole range.
But you can be very successful, going out and get some Miracle-Gro and be very successful.
As a very simple system, but a lot to learn, certainly.
Mm-hmm.
and a lot of sophistication that you can put into it.
Oh yeah, if you want to do it right. If you want to do it as a professionally to make money at it, of course you want to have the best tasting vegetables, you want to have the biggest yield for the amount of square foot, the amount of effort you're putting, you want the biggest yield so you can make the most amount of money at it. So mm-hmm. yeah, there's what if you build one of these at your home, you'll find that you have plenty of vegetables for yourself and your neighbors and the extended yeah. family.
Urban agriculture is increasingly becoming a way of life for people here in the District of Columbia and for urban dwellers around the world. The goal of the Agricultural Experiment Station Farm of the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences is to research and test techniques in urban agriculture that are consistent with sustainable practices. Here at Merkirk Research Farm, the focus of the Causes Center for Urban Agriculture and Gardening Education is on adapting successful, highly efficient farming techniques to small urban spaces. You have just learned about two such techniques, aquaponics and hydroponics. Thank you for joining me on Causes, a television program from the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia. If you would like more information, please visit us at www.udc.edu/causes. I am Sabine O'Hara. Thank you for watching. See you next time on Causes.